IBM, those shares are under some pressure today. MoffettNathanson initiating coverage of IBM with a sell rating, saying the recovery remains, quote, protracted and uncertain. Senior research analyst Lisa Ellis joins us now. It's her call today and our call of the day. It's good to see you. Thanks for coming out here.
Thank you.
So when Kramer and the gang this morning were discussing your call, they thought you were too negative. Why initiate with a sell? Do you think it's too harsh?
I don't. Look, I love IBM. It feels un-American to be negative IBM. The reality is they have 40% of revenues and 50% of profits in areas of enterprise IT that are in structural decline as a result of the cloud. Areas like hardware support, areas like data center outsourcing, licensed software. And that is, you know, that collectively it's declining 8% per year and it's not coming back.
So you essentially think that they have too small a percentage of revenues coming from the new high growth areas, machine learning, AI, and all of the sexy areas that we talk about and everybody else talks about every day.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, it's about 25% of revenue. It's growing 20%. I mean, the management team is doing a great job investing in those businesses, but they still have a serious growth math problem, right? An anchor problem. The anchor is much larger than the pieces that are growing. And the challenge is that a lot of that anchor is truly in structural decline, meaning it's not coming back. It's not a matter of turning it around. They've actually got to refill the bathtub with something else.
Yeah. At the same point, your price target is $150. Let's just call it even. We're almost there. So why not initiate with a hold? If you're being essentially paid to wait in a stock like this with a dividend yield of greater than 4%, why sell now?
Yeah, that's fair. I mean, these high dividend yield stocks, you know, it's trading right in line with like a AT&T or a Verizon that are high dividend yielding stocks. You know, there's a concern there that those may come under pressure as rates rise, right? They've been bond proxies over the last several years. So even though their current multiple is in line with those, it may come under pressure. And then, you know, from an earnings perspective, we just don't have significant earnings upside here over the next several years. You know, it's 2%, 3%.
I feel like we're almost in a debate over the time frame of what this company is trying to do, and its CEO, Ginni Rometty. You had a note last week, less than a week from UBS. They initiate coverage and they have a buy. And while they point to, you know, 2019 is sort of, look, we don't expect much, thus the dividend yield is attractive enough, a place to sort of hide out, 2020 is going to start to be the turning point. Are we just talking about the space of time where real changes can happen, or are you so negative over the long term structurally that that doesn't matter?
One, I definitely think the time frame is longer than that. When you're looking at 50% of the profits pool that still has to run off, that is measured in years, not in 1 or 2 years, for sure. So agree with that. And arguably, what they're doing in the growth areas, in cloud, in digital, is still somewhat uncertain. They've been a little bit late on the cloud front. They have a lot of assets they're bringing to bear there. They're doing what I'd call fine. But their cloud businesses are growing in the low 20s. I mean, Microsoft Azure put up over 100% last year.
How would Wall Street react if IBM made a massive acquisition and said that there weren't going to be any dividend raises and the buyback was no longer a priority, but they were going to get very aggressive into some of the areas that you talk about that are in structural ascendance as their traditional business wanes? How would you react? How would stock investors react?
Yeah, look, there would require maybe a little bit of a rotation in the investor base, but positively, for sure.
You think so?
I think so, if it's in the right space. So the wrong place is in SaaS. There's always this debate of should IBM buy Salesforce or buy Workday. That's not the right area because they are application agnostic. They sit at the lower layer than that. But a big acquisition, say, in the services side and in the consultancy business.
Do those companies exist on the publicly traded market? Or now are they big enough to move the needle? Without saying you think it's going to happen, who would fit the bill?
So on the in the services side, that there's, I mean, tons of companies, high growth services companies like the publicly listed. So this would be players like, for example, EPAM, Luxoft. These are some of these small scale digital pure play services companies that are
That would change the narrative around this, you're saying?
That would start to change the narrative. And the investments then would be, you know, more significant, a little less incremental.
Lisa, I own the stock. And so obviously I don't like seeing somebody come out and put a sell on it with a 150 price target. But that all being said, this transition that you talk about and the revenues, the way they're broken up, here's the issue I have. So what do you think about the CEO's role then? She's been there since 2012. We've watched Microsoft do this in a very short period of time. We're watching Intel and it was doing so. Many of these companies have changed from what they were to where they're going. And IBM doesn't seem to be able to do that. So is that an area where you'd say, you know what? You don't want to call for somebody's head, but that's got to change because this transition's taking too long.
I am supportive of the management team's strategy for sure. And Ginny inherited a challenge. She inherited it.
But that was 2012 now. That inheritance is six years old.
You know, they have taken a number of major steps, divesting several businesses. I think they've divested $7 billion in revenues. They've made $13 billion in acquisitions. They've made some big organizational changes. I mean, you can always debate rate and pace, but certainly the areas they're focused in are the right areas. Maybe the one area I'd point to is cloud. They were a little bit late, right? Their public cloud, the IBM branded cloud, didn't come out until 2016. Mm-hmm. Microsoft, that's 4 or 5 years past the other guys. So there's potentially a rate and pace debate. But when you're talking about a company of this scale, you know, it's sort of hard outside in to debate the rate and pace at which some of these changes are happening.
Part, what you're saying is you've got such this large ship that ran on a sandbar, and it's really hard to turn that ship off it and get it back on course in any sort of due time, right? I mean, most people think that Ginni Rometty has the company on the right track. Why have others been able to accomplish this
when they were sitting in a very similar spot is the point I'm trying to make, right? I mean, the Microsoft transition has been phenomenal, and we've seen it in some of the other names where the old is still there and it's still a presence, but they have made huge runs to the areas where they needed to go. I mean, Microsoft, the focus that they put on cloud and in Intel, as we talk about all the time, it's been on the data center, right? And that's the area of growth, and that's what everybody's pointing to. That's the future for them, I think, and that's the transition.
This is merely a debate over time about the length of time you as an investor is willing to wait.
Right.
Warren Buffett gave up on this stock. He holds stocks for decades.
Okay. So you're waiting over 5.5 years at this point.
Lisa, could you address that point, that sort of the Buffett factor? If the world's greatest investor throws in the towel, what kind of statement does that make?
Yeah.
Does that factor in it to any way that you view this company and the stock?
To a certain extent. I mean, it would be confirming evidence, right, that they're about the time frame, right? When you really get in and do the work and unpack what's going on under the covers, you can see that there's just a long way to go. And I would say where the challenge IBM has that's maybe a little bit different or more severe than some of these other players is that they are really heavy in infrastructure, in the core servers, the core middleware, the databases. And that's the piece of the whole IT stack that is truly going into structural decline.
So Michael Dell and EMC knew that you had to go public to turn around a business. Like, you can't do it in the public eye.
Right.
They had to go private, excuse me. Yeah. Is something like that even viable for IBM, or it's just too big?
I think so I haven't evaluated that, but I would imagine it's too big.
Right, I would too. Okay.
Lisa, thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
Good to talk to Lisa Ellis again, Moffett Nathanson.